Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about distributed systems, channels and messages, the routing of messages, and I'll shortly say something about the actor model. So let's get started. So in the previous video, you have seen concurrent systems in which there are multiple processes running simultaneously or are scheduled. Let's now consider distributed systems, which is a particular kind of concurrent system in which we have processes that are running on processors connected by networks. So, In distributed systems, you know one distributed system, which is, for instance, the internet. Eh? Possibly the device that you're watching this on is connected to the internet. How would you otherwise see this video? And now you could think of each of the processors connected in the network to be able to communicate with each other by exchanging messages. So let me explain to you in abstracto how this works. So just like before in concurrent systems, we have processes, and each process has its own control point. Let's assume it has a program that specifies its behavior. So there's a control point indicating where in the program the current execution of that program is. There is an associated call stack. That is local memory. Eh? So in distributed systems, every process has its own notion of memory. Eh? There is no such thing as a shared memory in a distributed system that every process can directly access. The only way that processes can communicate with each other is through networks. And the networks we could understand as forming a graph where each of the vertex in the graph represents a process, and now each edge between vertices represents a channel between the processes. So processes can then send and receive messages through their incident channels. Eh? So a process is associated to a vertex, and then you can ask yourself, well, what are the neighboring vertices? Those that are directly connected through an edge. And over those edges, we have associated channels. We can send and receive messages. Okay. So then, to give you a concrete example, let's consider three processes, A, B, and C. And let's say that A is connected to B, and B is connected to C. Now, you could imagine that there is a program that describes the following process, that process A repeatedly is performing some kind of job, and then after it has performed the job, it will send a message to process B. And this is possible because process A is directly connected to process B. Now, process B is sort of a forwarder, so what it does is repeatedly wait until it receives a message from process A. And then whenever it has received a message from A, it will send that message to process C. And now process C, you could think of repeatedly doing, it first waits for a message from process B, and then does some work processing that message. So this is an example of a distributed system with three processes, A, B, C, that are connected A to B and B to C. And as you can see, these processes cooperate with each other by exchanging messages. But how do these processes exchange messages? Well, for that you can imagine that between A and B there is a channel, and between B and C there is a channel. Now, whenever the process A wants to send a message to process B, it has to interact with the channel. And whenever process B wants to receive a message from process A, it has to also interact with that same channel between A and B. But there are different kinds of channels that you could imagine. Eh? So let's consider two kinds of channels. Let's say we have the synchronous channel, and by that I mean that both the sender and the receiver process have to be ready to interact with the channel. And you could think of this as a local barrier in which the process which sends and the process which receives both wait on each other to be there. So whenever both the process sender and the process that is receiving are there, then they could exchange a message. So imagine that the sender then actually sends the message to the receiver over the channel. And then after that, we can continue the sending process and we can continue the receiving process. So in practice, you could imagine that sending the message, you have to, as a sender, wait until that reception of the message is itself acknowledged. And as a receiver, you wait until the sender has indeed received the acknowledgement. So there is actually quite a complicated algorithm for making sure that these synchronous channels work in the way as I described them now. But let's not consider the details, but consider it on the abstract level. We have a sender and a receiver process, and whenever the sender wants to send, it has to wait until the receiver is also there. Then they can exchange the information, so the sender actually sends data to the receiver, and when that is successful, then both the sender and the receiver can continue. An alternative kind of channel is the asynchronous channel. And the asynchronous channel, you could imagine, works as follows. So the sender process interacts with the channel and it wants to send a message, and it does so by putting that message into a buffer. And so let's say some reserved space somewhere. Most likely there is some kind of device. Maybe you have some kind of cable between two machines, and to transmit signals over the cable that you put the message in a buffer, and then there is some kind of protocol that makes sure that the signal is then transmitted over the wire. Okay, so let's call this the send buffer. Now, once the sender has sent this message, the message is put in the send buffer, the sender process can already continue processing. So it does not have to wait for the receiver to be there. It can immediately continue processing, maybe doing other work. Now, suppose that later the receiver comes and the receiver waits. The receiver, it's on the other side. It's in a different part of the network. The receiver waits for a message, and then it will wait until there is a message in its, let's say, receive buffer. So in the meantime, this channel is making sure that whenever there is a message in the send buffer, that then the send buffer and the receiver buffer are synchronized, and that this exchange happens. So whenever that exchange has happened, then the receiving process can take the message out of its receiving buffer and then continue. And as you can see, the difference between the synchronous channel and the asynchronous channel is that in the synchronous channel, the sender has to wait for the receiver to be there before it can continue processing. Whereas in the asynchronous channel, the sender that sends a message can immediately continue processing, working on other things. So let's revisit the example of before, and let's consider again these three processes, A, B, and C, such that A is connected to B and B is connected to C. So what happens whenever we use synchronous channels between A and B and B and C? Well, what happens is that suppose the process A does some work and then wants to send a message to process B, the process A has to wait, in the case of a synchronous channel, until the process B is actually able and ready to receive a message from process A. So what that means is that once the process B wants to receive a message and the process A wants to send a message, they both can proceed, exchange the message, and then they can proceed. So in that case, A, in the meantime, continues performing some work, and B is now sending a message to process C. But for that, we need the process C to be ready to receive a message from process B, because there is also a synchronous channel between B and C. In that case, the process C receives a message from process B, and both B and C can continue, and C can do some work. So, because of the synchronous channel, it is always the case that whenever A does some work and then sends a message to B, then if it then does some more work, it can only send the second message to B whenever actually B completed its first send to C. Because then it repeats and receives again a message from A. But this message to C is only complete, the sending to the process C is only completed whenever the process C has actually received that message. So that means that the process A does some work, but it cannot continue working if the process C is very slow and it is very slow in processing its work. So the speed of process A, how fast process A can progress, depends with these synchronous channels on the speed of process C. Now consider alternatively that we put asynchronous channels between A and B and B and C. What is now the case is that the process A can do some work, and when it sends a message to process B, it puts this message on a buffer and it can immediately continue doing some work. Potentially again sending a message to process B, putting it again into a buffer. So in that case, what you have is that the process A can do a lot of work while the process C is very slow. But then at some point, of course, these channels, they cannot store an infinite amount of messages. So at some point later on, you will find out that some kind of delay feeds back. So that whenever process C indeed is very slow, that process A cannot become faster than process C that is processing the work. But let's consider these qualities of the channels, because it raises some interesting questions. There are different quality properties of channels. One quality property you could imagine is, well, what if there is some eavesdropper that is trying to snoop whatever is on the channel? What are the messages that are transmitted over a channel? For instance, the internet, this is quite an interesting case. What if there is a man in the middle that is trying to read the messages that you try to communicate over the network? Well, it is possible that someone could read the contents of the message when you send it. And if your goal is to ensure that the message contents remains confidential, well, then you need to apply certain techniques to ensure this quality property of the channel. So for instance, you could use encryption techniques on the channel to make sure that the channel contents, the messages that you transmit over the channel, are not readable by unintended parties. Another quality property that could hold of a channel consider the question, what if a channel is not perfect in transmitting its messages? What if the message that you transmit through the channel are, for instance, by natural factors, or maybe also attackers in the network corrupted? Well, in that case, imagine that there is someone or something that is tinkering with the message contents. That you can no longer trust that whenever you send a message, the same message as you sent is received by the other process, the process on the other end of the channel. So in this case, our goal is to protect the integrity of the message contents. And that means that whatever you send is actually the same as whatever you receive. And for that, you could use error detection algorithms. For instance, checksums that can then be used to check whether the data in the message has been tampered with. Okay, so that is the integrity quality property of a channel. There is also another question you could ask. What if channels, for instance, in the case of these asynchronous channels, are bounded. The buffer size is bounded. So the number of messages that you could temporarily store in this channel is not infinite. So it is the case that say you can store 10 messages and then afterwards your buffer is full. Well, what happens then? Well, you could have that if you then try to send another message on this channel, that because this buffer is full, that you have to do something with it. And that you can maybe drop the message, resulting in a loss. And if your goal now is to ensure that this message exchange remains available, so that it is possible, to actually exchange messages, well, then an approach would be, for instance, to have some kind of transmission protocol which retransmits the message whenever the message was lost. But if a lot of processes are, for instance, retransmitting the lost messages, it could lead to a superfluous amount of messages flying around channels. And this could cause congestion, just almost like the analogy where you have a road with traffic on it. And then, well, you could have traffic jams if there is too much traffic on the road. So these questions about quality, they raise maybe even more questions. But I mean, the purpose of this video is to let you at least be introduced with these concepts. So a channel can be confidential. It's a quality property of the channel. If you consider a channel to be confidential, if third parties cannot snoop on the message contents, you can argue that there is the quality property of the integrity of the channel whenever someone cannot tamper with the message contents. And you can argue that there is the quality property of availability if it is possible in the first place to transmit messages and not that your messages become lost. Okay, so that is the quality properties of channels. But now let's consider more. Up to now, I said to you, we have this network where the vertices are representing processes, and then the edges, each edge represents a channel between processes. But what if you now have a network and you want to transmit a message from one process to another process, but there is not a direct link, there is not a direct channel between the two processes? How is it then possible to transmit a message so that it will be eventually arriving at the intended process? So to do that, it is a possible solution to give every process a unique address, or you could say an identifier. And if every process has such a unique address, then you can put the messages you send around in the network in an envelope, and on top of the envelope you write the target address. And now whenever your target, so that is the intended recipient of your message, is not a directly incident process, so it is not directly connected to your process by a channel, you can forward the message to some intermediary vertex in your network, and that then will bring it closer and closer and closer to the intended recipient of the message. So what you then say is that if you have, for instance, received a message and you look at its envelope and the address on the envelope is not your process, well, then you have to do something with it, and then you forward it to your neighbors with the hope that the message will get closer and closer to its intended recipient. But now consider the following question. How do you now know where and in what direction you should forward these messages? Well, for that there are these things called routing algorithms. And routing algorithms make sure that each of the processes in the distributed system knows what are the neighbors that they have to forward the messages to make sure that the messages eventually arrive at their intended recipient. But this is an advanced topic. Let's not get into the details further here. But it is, of course, essential for a distributed system like the internet to have routing algorithms which have nice properties. For instance, whenever you want to route a message, you don't want it to travel all over the world while your intended recipient is sitting next to you. So you want this routing algorithm to include, for instance, a measure of distance and that you intend messages to travel the least amount of distance. But there are also other considerations, but let's not get into those details. You could also ask yourself the question, well, if I'm able to send messages by putting the recipient, the address of the recipient process on the envelope, is it then also possible to reply to a message? Well, what could you do? So if for every message you not only put the target address on it, so that is the intended recipient, but you also put your own address on it, then whenever the message is received, then the process that receives that message then knows where it came from and can send back a reply. Okay, so that is in abstracto routing. Let's consider now programming paradigm for working with these distributed systems. And for that, let me introduce you to the actor model. And the actor model you could think of as an extension of the object-oriented paradigm of programming. In object-oriented programming, you have these concepts of objects, that objects in that case would live in some kind of memory space. But now in our case, we don't have shared memory. There is no globally shared memory in a distributed system. So instead, what we have is that that we have special kinds of objects that we call actors. And these actors, the memory that is needed is stored in one particular process, and actors cannot directly read from the memory of other actors because they could be located on the other side of the globe. So let's think of an actor to be a special object that has, except for what objects have, like an encapsulated internal states comprising fields. An actor furthermore has, say, an incoming message box. And it has furthermore also a dedicated process, so a process associated to it that handles all the messages. It handles the incoming messages. And so an actor can be specified by specifying what to do whenever a message is received. So it is now possible, just like we had in object-oriented programming, to call methods on objects. But in the case of actors, you have to think that this calling of a method, then you have to conceptualize that an actor is in a particular location. And if you want to call a method on an actor that is in a different location, well, what you have to do then is to send a message such that the message eventually arrives at the actor's location. So you can send messages to other actors. Actors can send messages to other actors by calling its methods. And then under the hood, messages will then fly from one actor, maybe through a network, routed through a network, to eventually arrive at the other actor. And then the other actor can then handle the message once it's part of its incoming message box. Now, you can then think, okay, but how can you then, for instance, you perform a method call, but how do you then give back an answer, say a return value? Well, either the actor model allows you to, whenever you perform a call, that the message is sent to the recipient actor over a network, say, and then whenever the process that handles that method call terminates and it has a return value, that then the return value travels back over the network to the caller. Now this reception of these messages, they're all handled by handling the method calls. So you could imagine that for every actor there's this dedicated process, and this dedicated process basically selects from its incoming message box a message to process. And how does it process that? Well, by executing the associated call within its context. Okay, Now, again, in the actor model, you have, just like we had seen before, we have synchronous method calls. And what is a synchronous method call is that if one actor performs a call, that then a message flies to another actor. The other actor handles that message, and then it performs the execution of the procedure associated for handling that method call. And then once that is finished, then there is some kind of acknowledgement that is then sent back. And then the synchronous method call, it completes whenever such acknowledgement is received back. However, there is also the possibility of having asynchronous method calls. And an asynchronous method call is that an actor asynchronously calls another actor, but it doesn't wait on any acknowledgement, or it doesn't wait until it was processed by the other actor. No, it can immediately continue its own processing, so it doesn't have to wait. And so the analogy between synchronous and asynchronous channels on the one hand, and synchronous and asynchronous method calls on the other hand, this is very closely related to each other. Okay, and to give you an example of how you could, for instance, specify a program in this actor model with this that we have, instead of classes, we can define actors. So, for instance, we can define the actor A by defining what are its methods, and then implicitly under the hood, every actor, every object instance of this actor has an associated message box in which it receives incoming messages. And one way to handle such messages is the ping method that is stated over here. And there are input arguments, you could say. So, for instance, this actor A has a ping method. It does not provide a return value, but it requires as an input argument an address, so a reference to the act to an actor B. And then what does the handling of this method call do? Well, here I use the exclamation mark to indicate an asynchronous call. So here we perform an asynchronous call on the actor R, and we perform the call to the method Pong. And in the actor B, we have the method Pong. It doesn't return anything, and it doesn't take any argument, and it just prints hi. And now you could imagine that you then can construct two actors. Let's say we construct actor A and we construct actor B. And then we have a synchronous method call over here. So that means that whenever we call A dot ping, so then we call the method ping, we supply it the reference to this actor B. Now this call causes a message to be put into the message box of the actor A. And then the actor A has a dedicated process for handling these messages. So, okay, it looks at the ping. It has received a message for calling this ping method. So it handles then the ping call. It has received as an input argument the address of actor B, to which it then asynchronously sends. It performs this method call. So in the background, there is another message being sent. But since this is an asynchronous call, this procedure immediately completes. And after completing the procedure, since this is a synchronous call, there is an acknowledgement. Some acknowledgement is sent back to the process that is performing this call. And so then this one can print done. But since there was an asynchronous call to Pong, the process associated to actor B can, in the meantime, handle that Pong call. And then whenever it handles the Pong call, it will print hi. So what are the possible outputs you could imagine? Well, you could have that the process here, it creates A, it creates B, and then there is a synchronous call to ping, which then completes and it returns, and then you can have that it prints done. And then after done, we could have that the message was received at actor B, and that then it prints the text hi. But alternatively, we could also have that whenever we perform this synchronous call to ping, that this was over a long distance over the network, for instance. So whenever then this call here happened, that we have an asynchronous call to Pong, but that is on a short distance. So we could imagine that this asynchronous call Pong then is very shortly received afterwards, and we first print hi. And only after that print high, we have then that the long distance, so long latency for the reply, it takes some time, and then we have that we print done. So the order in which you see the messages high and done is it can be ordered in any way. Okay, so this gives you, on a very abstract level, at least an introduction to what is distributed systems, channels and messages, quality properties of channels, routing, and the actor model. So thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon again.